Hello students, welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Dr. Manisha Pandey, Assistant Professor in Biochemistry, School of Sciences, IGNU. Today, we are going to talk on module Biosafety and Biocontainment Part 1 under the paper Molecular Therapeutics. After going through this module, you'll be able to define GLP, explain its significance, then enlist various principles of GMP. You'll be also able to explain various potential microbiological hazards, its classification, then recognize the various biosafety levels needed to work on these microbiological agents, various containment facilities needed, and also define the concept of laboratory biosecurity. So, to begin with, first we will talk about some of the terms which we will be frequently using in this module, like biosafety. What is biosafety? You have heard about safety. When we say we should be safe, we mean we should protect ourselves from some kind of harm from the outside agents. Biosafety is safeguarding ourselves from the microbiological or biological agents which may cause us some kind of disease. To generally we refer it as potential biological hazards, and biosafety is also about safeguarding individual as well as safeguarding the environment as a whole as well as the community in which we are living. Another term which you will frequently come across is biocontainment. Biocontainment is nothing but the methods which we should follow to contain the spread of biological infections. Another term is biosecurity. Biosecurity and biosafety are sometimes mixed by the individuals, but generally these are two different terms. Biosafety is about personal safety, my safety, your safety. But when I say biosecurity, it means the safety of community, the safety of other people. For example, if I'm working on something, some biological hazard, some microorganisms, it should not harm the individual who was not working on that. It should not spread beyond my laboratory conditions. So, biosecurity, other security, biosafety, my security. Here we will talk about the various components of any biosafety and biocontainment program. Components means various aspects which must be taken into consideration when work is being done on biohazards. The aspects are administrative control, work practices, personal protective equipments, and engineering control. Administrative control means who is authorized to enter into the laboratory, who can carry out the research, what kind of security clearance are needed, which laboratory can perform work on what kind of the biohazard. By work practices, we mean laboratory practices, the standard operating protocols and the techniques which should be followed in the laboratory. Personal protective equipments are made for the protection of individual, the persons who are working into the laboratory. So their safety is ensured by personal protective equipments. This includes gloves, mask, boot, gowns, many things are there. And by engineering control, we mean the facility design of any laboratory. What kind of lab should be designed, whether it should be double door, automatically closing door, then where the laboratory should be located. So this all comes under the engineering control. Here we will talk about the work practices. In the previous slide, we mentioned about various aspects. So we are not taking into consideration the administrative controls because it requires clearance at the ministerial level, at the institutional level, which we will be dealing in the next module. Here we will talk about what kind of laboratory practices must be ensured. And to begin with, good laboratory practices, commonly referred to as GLP, is the best work practice which must be adhered. If we look into the historical background of GLP, It was introduced some 45 years back in New Zealand and Denmark for the first time. OSET laid down the principles for GLP in 1992, and in 2002, the Indian government, Department of Science and Technology, established a National GLP Compliance Monitoring Authority. So, NGCMA in India looks after the laboratory and their GLP compliance, and India in 2001 became the full-time member of OSET's group. In 2011, India became a full-time member of OSET's MAD, that is Mutual Acceptance of Data. So whatever data we are generating in Indian laboratory are equally acceptable by the labs abroad, as well as the data generated outside are used in India as well. We should adhere to GLP. Why? That is the big question, that why GLP should be adhered. It is an FDA regulation, and GLP provides a framework within which the laboratory study should be performed, recorded, reported, monitored. So it becomes a kind of primary requisite to ensure the safety of an individual as well as the environment. And if we look at the principles of GLP apply to all the non-clinical health and environmental safety studies. So GLP is kind of must if we want a kind of data sharing with other countries, a kind of reliability of our data. What is the significance of GLP? Why every nation should follow GLP? Every laboratory should adhere to GLP norms? Because GLP ensures quality and integrity. If GLP is followed into a laboratory, the data generated is reliable. It is used for risk assessment, risk to the individual as well as risk to the environment. And this data can be assessed for any pharmaceutical, agrochemical, cosmetic, food or feed, or any novel food or biocide. So the data generated ensures the quality as well as integrity. Principles of GLP. The OSET has laid down 10 principles of GLP. The commandments are test facility organization and personnel, then quality assurance program, which every laboratory must adhere, facilities, what kind of laboratory should be constructed, where it should be located, whether it is of the adequate size or not. Next is about apparatus, material and reagents, which ensures whether the computerized system has been followed for the generation, storage and retrieval of data about the adequate capacity related to apparatus and material, whether it is periodically inspected, cleaned, maintained or not. Test systems, whether it has been suitably located, whether the design is adequate or not, whether the capacity is adequate or not. It also talks about test and reference items, standard operating procedures, which every laboratory must comply, and then about the performance of the study, reporting of the study results. Whatever the project is being undertaken into laboratory, a standard reporting must be followed, a timeline should be adhered, it should be properly noted down. And the last is storage and retention of records. Every data, every information should be properly noted with the signature of PI. The date should be there. So the GLP laid down 10 principles, which when adhered ensures the integrity as well as the quality of data generated, which we mentioned earlier that can be used for assessing that whether the required pharmaceutical or any chemical is harmful to an individual or not. And based on that, it also facilitates the export and import of those products into different nations. Since we are talking about the biosafety and biocontainment, so after talking about the work practices, we'll come to the biohazards or why we need biosafety, because we are working on the biological hazardous agents or normally we call as potential biological hazardous agents, which are used in research. If we look at the Gazette Notification 343 of Indian Government, which was published in 1998 on biomedical waste, the Government of India has defined the term biological as any preparation made from organisms or microorganisms or product of metabolism and biochemical reactions intended for use in the diagnosis, immunization, or the treatment of human beings or animals or in research activities pertaining thereto. This means that if we try to simplify and look at it, any research where the microorganisms are used, for example, bacteria, viruses, viroids, prions, rickettsia, fungi, parasite, or whether the research work is involved in recombinant DNA technology, like the genetic material from one organism is being transferred into the another, or human or animal sample is involved, it can be fresh sample, it can be frozen sample, blood is there, or any body fluid is involved in the research. So this comes into the category of potential hazardous material, in brief, referred to as PBHA. This shows the symbols which is used to symbolize or identify biohazard. Any laboratory, if they are having this symbol, then anyone can clearly make out that this laboratory is involved in research where some biohazard is being used, like some microorganism is used, or they're working on some viruses, bacteria, human blood samples, which may pose some risk to the individual or to the environment. Here, you are looking at the various symbols. All the symbols are same. They are made up of three rings, which are not closed from the open or margin side. So depending on the laboratory situation and individual choice, any symbol can be taken up, but they all signify a biohazard. In the previous slide, you have seen the symbol of biohazard. Whenever you enter a laboratory and you come across that circular sign with three circles, which are open from the outside, they signify biohazard or microorganism is used for research purposes in that laboratory. And these microorganisms have been divided into different levels or different risk groups based on their severity of causing the disease, their transmission. So we'll look at the levels. These biological hazards are divided into four risk groups. BSL1, it is the lowest risk. It doesn't cause much infection to the individual who is working on it. But as we move upward, BSL2 pose moderate risk. BSL3 and BSL4 are high risk biohazard. They cause severe infections to the individual. The difference between 3 and 4 is BSL3 has got prophylactic treatment. It generally doesn't spread to the community. Individual may get harm, individual may get severe infection, but in BSL4 what happens is there are chances that the disease may spread to community at large, as well as the microorganisms belonging to BSL4 category are exotic in nature. So there may not be viable prophylactic treatments available. Here we will classify the microorganisms. Broadly, we are referring as biohazard into various risk groups. These risk groups are based on biosafety levels. Four risk group has been identified. Four biosafety levels are there. So increasingly, going from risk group 1 to risk group 4, the risk to individual, the severity of infection to individual increases. If we look at each group separately, risk group 1 involves microorganisms which are either having no risk to the individual or have very low disease causing capacity to the individual, and generally the community is at no risk. But when we look at risk group 2, the microorganisms in risk group 2 has moderate capacity for risk to the individual, very low capacity for risk to the community, and they can cause disease to the person or the individual who is working on them. If we look at risk group 3, the microorganisms belonging to risk group 3 pose high risk to the individual and low risk to the community. The disease caused to the individual is serious, and if we look at the treatment part, although there is effective prophylaxis and treatment is available, but the level of infection is high to the individual, although the disease caused may not spread to other individuals in the community. In risk group 4, the microorganisms have very high disease causing capacity, so the individual is at very high risk of exposure, and community at large is also at risk. It can cause severe disease to the individual as well as any animal, and the severity of infection can spread in the community. There is no treatment or no viable treatment is available to control the disease or infection caused by risk group 4. So after classifying the microorganisms into various risk groups, we'll talk about the specific microorganisms which are placed into these groups, and interchangeably we'll be using the term either biosafety level or risk group, which means when I say risk group 1, I refer to biosafety level 1 or vice versa. So in risk group 1 or biosafety level 1, the microorganisms which are handled in any laboratory are non-pathogenic, that is, they do not cause risk to the individual. If we look at some of the examples of BSL-1 category, it involves non-pathogenic strain of Escherichia coli, slime molds, edible mushrooms, lactobacillus, the bacteria Bacillus thuringiensis, which you have been very commonly listening about Bt cotton. The gene from this bacteria has been used for Bt cotton. Many nitrogen-fixing bacteria, oil-eating bacteria, when they are introduced into their natural environment and handled in the laboratory, come or belong to BSL-1 category. If we look at some of the examples of BSL-2 category, these microorganisms have the capacity to cause diseases. The individual is at risk, and moderately the community is also at risk. If we look at the examples, the deadly hepatitis A, B, and C virus belong to BSL-2 category. Even the pathogenic strain of Escherichia coli has been placed into BSL-2 category. Depending on the hazard it can pose to the individual and environment, other examples are Plasmodium falciparum, Staphylococcus, measles virus, even the bacteria Mycobacterium and HIV viruses are placed into BSL-2 category. The laboratories which work on blood-borne pathogens or human fluids also are placed into BSL-2, or any laboratory which is handling these kind of samples is placed into BSL-2. BSL-3 or risk group 3, if you look at the examples, Mycobacterium tuberculosis, Mycobacterium bovis, which causes the TB or tuberculosis, H1N1 flu, avian influenza, even chikungunya, yellow fever, these microorganisms have been placed into risk group 3, and the biosafety levels where the specific precaution should be taken while working on these microorganisms belongs to BSL-3 category. The risk posed to individual is high, the risk posed to community is also more, but the prophylactic treatment is available. BSL-4, microorganisms belonging to this category are highly dangerous, fatal, and exotic. Means they don't have the origin into the native countries where the disease is being caused. For example, the Ebola virus, Crimean Congo hemorrhagic fever, BSL-4, the microorganisms handled into this category are highly dangerous. The disease caused may be fatal. Community is also at risk. Prophylactic treatment may not be available or viable. If we look at some of the examples, Marburg virus, Ebola virus, which you have heard probably, even Crimean Congo hemorrhagic fever, the virus which causes it belong to BSL-4. Now we'll talk about the personal protective equipments, PPE generally we refer at. These are protective devices, measures, clothings, which every researcher should use while working on the microorganisms or biological hazards. We are looking at the BSL-1 protective equipments. What you are seeing is a biosafety cabinet in which the researcher is working on some biological sample. But what the individual has put on? A gown. So primary containment, primary protection is work is done in a cabinet. And secondly, there is a gown. And then the individual is wearing a glove. If we go to next level, the safety level 2, here the protective equipments are more. They are built on primary level. The work is being carried out in a biological safety cabinet. Then individual is fully covered with a dress. They are having a headgear. Sometimes they cover their eyes as well. Gloves is there. So the personal protection is there as well as the biological safety gear is there. While in the first, what was there is generally we were using a simple gown, but here it is different. If we go to another level, the BSL-3 category, in BSL-3 and BSL-4 category, generally the clothing which is put on is different. Individual is fully covered. The eyes are covered, the hand is covered, safety cabinets are class 2 or class 3 type, and in BSL-4 it is further different. Individual may be fully covered from top to bottom. They are provided with a kind of tubes through which fresh air is provided to them to breathe so that they are not breathing into the laboratory air which may be contaminated from the environment. If we look at a picture which has been given by the Robert Koch Institute, which is a BSL-4 laboratory, here what you can see is the access is controlled. Everyone cannot enter into the laboratory. One who are trained, who are authorized to work into that kind of laboratory, enter into that. Once they enter into the laboratory, there is a double door kind of thing. So you take out your clothing, you go wear another clothing, you take a wash, go into the laboratory, work, come back, again take a shower, then put your clothing there, wear your, have a shower again, wear your own clothing and go out. So it is like you don on and you don off the laboratory wear. You are not carrying the laboratory microorganisms which are attached to your clothing to outside. So these are various safety devices, measures which are adopted while working into different kind of laboratories. We'll talk about biocontainment. Biosafety and biocontainment go together. If we are working on the microorganisms, we should take some precautions to protect ourselves. And biocontainment talks about the physical containment of the biological hazard. This term was coined way back in 1985 and it relates to how physically we can control any pathogenic organism, be it bacteria, virus or toxin, while working on it in any laboratory so that neither the environment nor the individual is exposed to it, the primary biocontainment which we generally use in our labs is cabinets. It prevents the accidental infection of workers, and it also helps in protecting the community during the scientific researches. The biocontainment can be divided into two categories, the primary containment and secondary containment. Primary containment means how we are using properly various storage containers to store the microorganisms, then various microbiological techniques are being followed, whether the appropriate safety equipments and biological safety cabinets are used or not. So, primary containment means at the first level or beginning level, while working on the microorganism, what safety precautions must be taken so that the individual is not exposed to any kind of risk. Secondary containment is protection of the environment external to the laboratory from exposure. Means how the facility should be designed, what should be the operational practices so that beyond the laboratory boundaries, the environment or other individuals are not exposed to the microorganisms which are used in the laboratory for some research activities. In the beginning, we were talking about biosafety levels separately. We had talked about the containments also. Now we'll link the two, the biosafety level as well as the primary containments. We'll discuss each BSL level one by one. For biosafety level one, if we look at the very common examples, the basic teaching laboratories in our schools and colleges, the water testing laboratories belong to BSL 1 category. In these laboratory, the practices which are generally followed or practiced are good microbiological techniques. The decontamination is generally done by chemical disinfectants or autoclaving. What is required is the BSL 1 laboratory should also have a sink for hand washing and use of personal protective equipments like gowns and gloves should be adhered. If you remember, in your school, we have always been wearing aprons while working in the laboratory. So they are nothing but the primary containments. And the safety equipments in these kind of laboratories are generally none, and the work is performed on the open benches. If we talk about BSL 2 laboratories, any diagnostic laboratory, be it a primary health service, teaching or public health, belongs to BSL 2 and containment facilities are required. Any BSL level builds on the previous level. So whatever laboratory practices are followed in the BSL 1 should be adhered. Along with that, there are other laboratory practices which are added to BSL 2 level. So good microbiological technique should be followed. There should be decontamination facilities. Sink must be there. The protective personal clothing should be there. Apart from that, in BSL 2 labs, the biohazard sign is very clearly placed. So whenever you enter a BSL 2 lab, that three circle diagram which you saw in the previous slide is there, which makes anyone aware that, okay, this is a BSL 2 lab. The microorganisms or any kind of biohazard is used in this laboratory. These laboratories have restricted entries and generally the doors are self-closing. The work done in these laboratories are under the expert supervision. A trained person guides the individual, whosoever is working, how to perform the experiments. The benches are open and the biosafety cabinets are used for performing researches on BSL 2 facilities. The BSL 3 facility are practiced in special diagnostic laboratories. This requires very high containment facilities. apart from the laboratory practices in BSL-2, the personal protective equipments are very different for this. They have a very solid front. The entry to the laboratory has very controlled access. Everyone cannot enter the laboratory frequently. It has a HEPA-filtered room. The exhaust has a directional airflow. So it's not like that the air is flowing from the laboratory to the entire area. It has a directional flow where it should go, whether it should be decontaminated before being released into the environment or not. And limited access is provided with the double door changing room. So whosoever enters the laboratory must change their clothing before entering into the laboratory, as well as while exiting also they should change their clothes. If we look at the safety equipments, the BSE-2 or BSE-3 type cabinets are used while working on the risk group 3 microorganisms or BSL safety level. BSL-4 safety level involves high risk pathogens. So the example of BSL-4 laboratories can be divided into two types: cabinet labs and suit labs. So cabinet labs, there the work is performed inside the cabinet only. Individual is not directly touching anything. And suit labs, where the individual researchers wear a proper gown while working on these microorganisms. If we look at the laboratory practices, it builds on level 3. The entry to these laboratories have an airlock entry system. Shower exit and shower entry is must. Special waste disposal technique is followed. And 2-person rule is adhered. By 2-person rule, we mean that 2 persons should work together in a BSL-4 laboratory. Single individual is not permitted or allowed to work on the microorganisms. So 2 persons together work in the laboratory. The safety equipment part, if we look at, they wear a very different type of gown, which we mentioned as suit labs. So they wear a positive air pressure supply suits in which they are not breathing into the laboratory air. The fresh air is supplied to them because the laboratory air may be having some microbe, and via that breathing or through air, they may get some contamination. Generally, the BSE-3 or class 3 cabinets are used for working on risk group 4 or BSL-4 microorganisms. We'll talk about biological safety cabinets, which we were referring into the previous slides. There are 3 types of biological safety cabinets, generally referred to as BSE class 1, 2 and 3. And this classification into 3 levels is based on containment capability and performance attribute of the cabinet. The safety cabinets provide safety to the personnel as well as to the environment, but they do not prevent the product from contamination. So even if we are working on the biological safety cabinets, the product may get contaminated from the air which is flowing inside the room, and contaminating the or coming in touch with the product may cause its contamination. Now we are looking at the safety cabinet. It is a line diagram of a safety cabinet, not a real safety cabinet which you see into the laboratory. Purpose of showing the line diagram is how the air is circulating into the laboratory safety cabinet. In class 1 safety cabinet, we talked there is personal security, there is environmental security, but there is no product being secured. So product is susceptible to contamination. What is happening? The room air enters into the cabinet. The cabinet air is flowing and moving into the room. So chances of contamination is there, although the individual is safe. We look at the BSE class 2 cabinets. In class 2 cabinets, what happens is it is attached to the HEPA filter. The cabinet air is moved out. Room air enters into that, but cabinet air moves out. So it protects the individual more from getting some kind of infection, as well as it also ensures product contamination. If we talk about biological safety cabinet class 2 type, they provide product protection as well, apart from personal and environment protection. These type of BSC cabinets are generally used in clinical laboratories, hospitals, life sciences, research and pharmaceutical laboratories. There are four variants of BSC class 2 available nowadays. It has been divided into type A and type B, and further divided into A1, A2 and B1, B2. This division is based on the circulation of air. So which particular variant of type 2 is suitable for working on the microorganisms? Which area of cabinet is safe for working on the microorganisms? So there are different variants of safety cabinets, but what is to be noted here is the class 2 cabinets provide protection to the individual as well as to the product. This is the image of a class 3 cabinet. We talked about two things. In class 3 cabinet, the first image which you are seeing from the front is individual can see from a microscope. Air which is entering into the cabinet is filtered. The air which is going out from the cabinet has been filtered. So there is no contamination allowed. The air of the cabinet is circulating within the cabinet only. It is not entering the room. So it is the highest level of security, safety, which can be provided while working into a laboratory. The class 3 cabinets are designed specially to work on class 4 microbiological agents or high risk agents. So the protection provided is also maximum to the environment as well as to the worker. The class 3 cabinets are generally gas tight, having sealed enclosures with a viewing window, so that you are not exposed to the microorganism, but you view it from a window while working on it. The access to the interior of cabinet is generally through a double door, which has an interchange box, and it can be decontaminated between uses. The supply of air both in and out is HEPA filtered. Generally, the long heavy duty rubber gloves are attached in these cabinets in a gas tight manner, and they provide the prevention or separation, and the heavy duty rubber gloves prevent the direct contact between the individual user and the hazardous material. Now we'll talk about laboratory biosecurity concept. By laboratory biosecurity, we mean how we can secure the nearby area of a laboratory. This is a layman's definition. Just imagine there is a laboratory in your close vicinity. Some kind of microorganism is being used for research purposes. Generally, those who are living in that area are in some kind of tension, apprehension, what is happening there, whether it will cause some disease to us or not. So the concept, the laboratory biosecurity concept, ensures that those who are not working on those kind of microorganism, they are protected, they are not harmed. This reduces the risk of unauthorized access, loss, theft, misuse, or diversion or intentional release of microbiological material into the community. Biosecurity is all about protecting others. Safety is about protecting ourselves. The term biosecurity was for the first time used by agriculture and environmental scientists. It encompasses or talks about the prevention of intentional removal of biohazard from research laboratory. For example, let's say I'm working into a laboratory. It has got a dual use. It is being used for finding out some cure to a particular disease, but it may fall into the hands of some persons who may use it for bad purposes, for harming the community at large. So biosecurity is all about prevention of intentional removal of biological material from laboratory. And if you look at the WHO 2006 guideline, it says that the general public expects laboratory personnel to act responsibly and not to expose the community to various bio risks. They must follow safe working practices, that is biosafety, and the work and material should be safe in a secure place, that is biosecurity, and they should also practice ethical codes of conduct, that is bioethics. There are various issues attached to biosecurity, like what should be done so that the security of biological hazard is assured. First and foremost is coordination among various administrative organizations, regulatory as well as physical security procedures, like authorizing the personnel, who should work, what should be done, how they should work, that should be taken care of. Then it talks about biosafety practices. And the third and utmost is a cooperation between various scientists, technicians, policy makers, law enforcement officials, so that this issue is addressed properly. Now let us summarize what we have learned in this module. We learned about the work practices, that is GLP, why GLP compliance is necessary, what it gives back, like the significance of GLP. Then you have learned about the 10 principles of GLP, the 10 commandments, which must be practiced into any laboratory. You have also learned about the various biological agents, their classification into different risk groups. And these risk groups are also parallelly referred to as biological safety levels. So you have learned about various biosafety levels, level 1 to level 4, what kind of practices are adopted while working on these, what kind of biocontainment facilities are needed, and also we have introduced the concept of laboratory biosecurity. Hope this will help you in understanding the topics better. Thank you.